Hi guys, so welcome to another new video of Reagent Blues, episode number 2. And today I am going to be talking about another useful but a difficult to handle reagent, and that is diazomethane. Okay, so from many of you I received a feedback that my video on reagents was too long and that you know, it is difficult to watch the whole video. So I'll try and make it short, and that's why I have already written down many of the reactions that diazomethane is used in. Okay, and obviously, like, a reagent has lot many uses, and actually my criteria was to cover all the reactions that a particular reagent does, but since it takes too much time and many of you don't watch it till the end, so I think there's no point of making such a long video. So definitely I'm going to keep it short, and like always I'm going to tell you about the reagent and then a short incident associated with it. Okay, so diazomethane, first of all, CH2N2, okay, it is a good methylating agent. And for example, if the first reaction that I will talk about is esterification. So whenever you have a very acidic proton, for example in this acidic group P double bond OH, it simply leads to the addition of methyl. Okay, methyl, since it's a methylating agent, we get OME. Okay, so this acidic proton H is removed and instead we get a methyl or methyl group. Then we have carboxylic acid. Similarly, we have a OH, acidic OH, and it leads to esterification and we get an ester. Okay, simply the proton is replaced by the methyl group. Then if we have a dicarboxylic acid, this is one important reaction. In presence of diazomethane and alumina, it can selectively lead to methylation of one of the carboxylic acids, and the other one can be remain as it is. So it is a very chemoselective reaction. Now over here, as you can see, what happens is this one of the carboxylic acids, if we are adding alumina, so one of the carboxylic acids basically binds to this alumina. Okay, one of the two carboxylic groups binds to the alumina, so the other one is left free. So the other one is then methylated, and one remains as it is. So it is a chemoselective reaction. Now coming on to methylation of alcohols, even alcohols can be methylated. Okay, but for that we need tetrafluoroboric acid, or in the presence of boron trifluoride etherate. Okay, this BF3.OET is known as boron trifluoride etherate. So either in the presence of boron trifluoride etherate or in the presence of tetrafluoroboric acid, we can in fact convert alcohols also to ethers. Okay, we can methylate these alcohols, this H group again replaced by methyl group. Then we have photochemical reaction. If we have a cis alkene, okay, and a singlet carbene is generated with the help of the photochemical reaction by addition of diazomethane, then only in case of singlet carbene is generated, and generally for photochemical reactions a singlet carbene is generated, only if we have special conditions, only then we can generate a triplet carbene. So singlet carbenes only give one product, and that is this product, cis cyclopropane, where the methyl groups are cis to each other. Okay, but if we have a triplet carbene, then we get a mixture of cis methyl groups and trans methyl groups. No doubt we get cyclopropane only, but there is a mixture of cis and trans methyl groups. But for singlet carbenes, we only get the cis methyl group. Then this diazomethane is also used in one of the popular name reactions, and that is Arndt-Eichstätt synthesis. Okay, which I mentioned over here. So if you have acid chloride, for example, which I have taken over here, on addition of diazomethane followed by the addition of alcohol, what we get is basically this chloride is replaced by the alcohol. So for example, here we have benzyl alcohol. So the benzyl group, O benzyl group, has been replaced. Instead of the chlorine, we have the O benzyl group. Similarly, if we have methanol over here, that is MEOH. So if we add methanol in the same reaction instead of benzyl alcohol, we will get OME. Right? So only you have to replace the chloride with the alcohol. So these are the certain reactions that this diazomethane reagent gives. Okay, it's a very good methylating agent, but like I said, the handling of this reagent is very, very difficult, and so industry it is not that feasible. And you might have heard of this process called diazotization. Okay, It is also used in dye industries. And this diazomethane is the smallest diazo compound, okay? And I think in my previous click chemistry video, I had told you that the higher the carbon nitrogen ratio, the stable the compound. The lower the carbon to nitrogen ratio, the more unstable the compound. So you can see the carbon to nitrogen ratio is very, very low in this case, in the case of diazomethane. That is why it's very explosive. Similarly, in dye industries also, we are using diazo compounds, and there are many explosions and many fires that have taken place in dye industries because of diazo compounds. Okay, and since this is the smallest diazo compound, hence it's very, very explosive. Not to mention that it is toxic as well. There are certain other reactions with ketones and aldehydes which I was unable to discuss because already the space is taken up. Okay, so I would advise you, it's a very important reagent and many questions are asked from that, right? So I would advise you that you go ahead and watch videos or just Google the applications of diazomethane to ketones and aldehydes. Okay, I think that is the only reaction that I have left out. Rest all I have covered over here. Now let's talk about the handling. Okay, now before I start talking about the handling, just remember this thing that I am also surveying or reading articles and then bringing this information to you. So if in case someday you are using diazomethane, or like in my previous video, if someday you are using tertiary butyl lithium, always look up the safety data sheet. Always talk to your seniors on how to work on that reagent. What is the procedure? Because these are really dangerous reagents, and you could lose your lives if you do not take proper precautions. Okay, so do not go by my word. Always consult your seniors. Look into the safety data sheet, and then plan your methodology accordingly. Okay. Anyway, so what information I have gathered, I'll let you know, and why have I taken this reagent, because it gives you a very important lesson. So now let's come on to the incident. So diazomethane, first of all, it's toxic. Okay, it is known to cause pulmonary edema. That is, you have chest congestion and you have asthma-like symptoms, and these develop at a later stage. Okay, so once you're exposed to diazomethane, you will never know that you have been exposed. Only after a while you will get to know, getting the symptoms of pulmonary edema. Along with that, it's very explosive. So it is very important to use it in a solvent in a diluted form. For example, in diethyl ether. Generally, it is used in diethyl ether, and it forms a yellowish solution in diethyl ether. So, and even in the undiluted form, it is very explosive. Okay, so it is recommended that that whenever you are doing a reaction with diazomethane, first of all you do it in a chemical wood with the window down. Okay, then you have to wear double gloves protection. Okay, just in case the blast takes place, your hands don't get hurt. The third is, you have to wear a blast shield. Okay, so there is something called as a blast shield, which unfortunately is not available in most of the institutes in India. Okay, no doubt that we don't even use such reagents, but I think a blast shield should be there in every laboratory in India, but unfortunately there is no blast shield over here. So you should have a blast shield, you should have double gloves, and you should be working in a fume hood which is properly working. It should not be malfunctioning, because if you are exposed to diazomethane, the vapors of diazomethane, it can be a horrific horror. It could be a horror. Okay, anyway, so now the important thing that I wanted to discuss was, so people came out with an alternative of diazomethane, that is TMS diazomethane. It is a more stable form of diazomethane, and it's called trimethylsilyl diazomethane, TMS diazomethane. So industry started working with trimethylsilyl diazomethane because it is much more stable than diazomethane. Now what happened was, so the lesson learned over here is that there are some compounds which are being used in the industry which do not have a safety data sheet. For example, TMS diazomethane did not have a safety data sheet. I mean, the articles that I have read till that point of time, in those articles there was no TMS data sheet available for diazomethane. That is, there have been no toxicological screenings done to identify what is the what harm could diazomethane lead to. And still they are being synthesized and they are being sent to laboratories where people are using it at their own risk. Okay. So two incidents took place regarding TMS diazomethane. Even though diazomethane is more explosive, yet the incidents that happened, there were two fatalities. One was in 2008 of a 24-year-old scientist who was working in a pharma company, or I think in a manufacturing company, and he was synthesizing this TMS diazomethane. So what happened was, there was no report of TMS diazomethane causing any kind of side effects or any kind of toxic nature of TMS diazomethane. So he was working with it, and what happened was, he came up in the morning, he had a morning shift, and by 8 o'clock he was trying to synthesize diazomethane, and because of some reason the diazomethane got spilled. 300 to 400 ml of diazomethane, trimethyl diazomethane, got spilled. So he cleaned it up, okay, and he told his senior that, you know, he was 24 years old. Okay, let me just check whether it's filming or not. Right, so he was 24 years old, and he decided that it got spilled, and so he cleaned it up, and he told his senior that I have cleaned this up. So later on in the afternoon, the senior came to him and he said are you fine? And he said, yeah, I'm totally fine, there's no side effects or no problem that I have. Once he went home, he had a friend, and the friend then suddenly in the night he started feeling breathlessness. Okay, he was short of breath, and he became unconscious in a while. He was admitted to the hospital, and later on in the hospital he died. And so the doctor said that this happened because of asthma like symptoms, that is pulmonary edema. So even though nothing was known about TMS diazomethane, so nobody could figure out that it can have such a side effect. Though still, when I was doing the case study, in the case study it is mentioned that it is not still proven whether it was because of TMS diazomethane or because of some reaction of TMS diazomethane with some other compound leading to synthesis of a very toxic compound. So nobody still now knows whether that the TMS diazomethane led to that incident, because there has been no safety studies done on TMS diazomethane. Okay, similarly, in Canada, 46-year-old scientist, and now this guy is very experienced, he was also working with TMS diazomethane, and his fume hood was not working properly. It was under maintenance because of some construction work that was going on the upper floor. So his fume hood was under maintenance, and he was working with TMS diazomethane, and same symptoms happened to him that happened to this guy earlier, the 24-year-old guy, and he too died because of lung failure. And so the problem was that there was no ventilation in the lab and the fume hood was not working. So maybe because of the lack of ventilation, the fumes of TMS diazomethane were generated, and that led to his death. Okay, so whenever you're working with TMS diazomethane or diazomethane, always make sure, or whenever you're working with a hazardous compound which is toxic, not just this compound, any hazardous compound which is toxic, always make sure that you have your either your respiratory proper respiratory care, whichever is advised by the manufacturer of that particular chemical. So whenever you are getting a chemical from some manufacturer, they will advise you some things to do, and always, you know, pay attention to those things and do those things. Okay, so always have your mask on, whichever proper cartridge, whatever mask is there. Always have a well ventilated lab. You should always work with toxic reagents when the fume hood is working and under the fume hood. Never to work with them outside the fume hood. Okay, that is also one very important lesson to be learned. So well ventilation of the lab. So this video was because I wanted you to stress on these things, that well ventilated lab is a must, proper care, okay, that is your mask, your gloves, if required your blast shield, or otherwise your normal glasses is a must. Okay, and because you never know what kind of reaction happens and when a small blast can take place. So even a small RB, if it bursts, the the RP, the glass pieces can still go into your eye, right? And yeah, one more thing that I forgot to mention is diazomethane is so reactive that even if you have small scratches in your glassware, or if you have a uneven surface, rough surface on your glassware, it can explode just by interacting with those rough edges or scratches. So for diazomethane, generally special equipment is come, which is known as flame joints, flame joint glassware. Okay, so these are specially designed glasswares to be used for diazomethane, and they are available commercially. So if you are working with diazomethanes, this is a very important thing, and thank God I remembered, because it is so reactive and so explosive that even if it comes with small scratches in your glassware, it can explode. And we all know that our glassware definitely has small scratches. So it is a must to use specialized glassware, which is flame joint glassware, and you can find it commercially, right? So I hope this is a short video and you watch it to the end. And if you like it, please give it a big thumbs up, subscribe and share to my channel, right? Thank you so much.